Ladies and gentlemen, welcome wrestling fans worldwide to Knoxville and the Great Smoky Mountains for the Ron Fuller Tennessee Studcast.
6 feet 9 inches tall, 265 pounds.
This historic podcast from one of the most respected and successful wrestlers and promoters will follow the footsteps of the largest and oldest wrestling family on the planet.
Listen to what I'm saying. That's right. Bring that camera in here a little bit closer.
Through 93 years and four generations.
The stud has arrived.
Old school or new fan, this unique broadcast will educate and captivate as Ron details decades of professional wrestling's growth with truly unforgettable stories.
I want those people out there at home to hear the stud.
Sit back and enjoy the ride with the Tennessee Stud.
The Tennessee Stud. You will learn that name. You will remember it.
And now,
the stud is here.
All right, Studcast fans, let's get it started. It's David Summers, and here comes another Studcast with the Tennessee Stud, Ron Fuller. This is the story of wrestling in America, as told by the stud, whose family started the profession over 100 years ago. So let's step back into the ring and back into time as we get wall to wall and tree top tall with the Tennessee Stud, Ron Fuller. Hey, Ron, I got to tell you, your hidden history lesson from the last Studcast on Roy's Bear Ginger, I thought it was really off the charts good. As a matter of fact, so was your answer to the learning tree question near the end of the show that you had from last week, too. The wrestling history you've covered in the last Studcast spanned almost 50 years of wrestling information. I think that's really cool.
Well, that's a big time frame there for darn sure, you know. So, and I really enjoyed, man, telling that entire Ginger story. That's the first time I've ever had the opportunity to do that on a Studcast. And it obviously is true wrestling history, and it kind of a story that needs to be told, and some of it is the kind of thing that makes the sport, I mean, in a way, so absolutely unforgettable. The learning tree question about the four NWA world champions in the decade of the 1970s and which one I preferred to wrestle the most was obviously a great question. And as all those learning tree questions are, man, we have some extremely knowledgeable fans that listen to these Studcasts, man. And I'm always amazed at the great answers, the questions that they ask. They're just all over everywhere, and all of them really, really good. And speaking of that, I have another Ask the Stud question and answer show. Happens to be coming out exclusively on the YouTube Southeastern Rewind channel. It's going to be coming out this Saturday, April 20th. We're talking about in 2024. We're recording this one, and I've already gotten a lot of great questions, you know, and I'm really proud, man, of all the questions, man, and the people, you know, I love these monthly hour shows that I do, and this one is going to be, Dave, the 16th one, man.
Wow,
I'm already in my second year of Ask the Stud shows.
That's cool. So there's like one every month, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Boom. Yeah. All right. So, yeah, you've been knocking that down for a while. I think that's cool because most everything you do is for the fans, and it's right back to and with the fans. And I think that is just the way to go. You're also about halfway through your seven years at the end of it. Once we hit the full, you're in 6.5 years so far of Studcast, not to mention 43 super Studcasts on your tnstud.com website. By the way, every one of the Studcast, every one of these, this is episode number 345. Every one you can find on tnstud.com, in addition to those 43 really good super Studcasts. You got to check that out. Listen, you've been one of the busiest wrestlers in history, in my opinion, when it comes to sharing your knowledge. You take fans back into the 100 years of wrestling in your family. And that's what we're going to do again today. All right, so where do we ride first? How do we get there? What are we going to do?
Well, we're going to finish the hidden history lessons with my grandfather, Roy. This is going to be the last one. And I'm also going to take us into some history of the National Wrestling Alliance, the NWA, that was founded in 1948. We're going to go from my grandfather to an organization he was a part of. And we're going to also take a look at the second week in April of 1980 at the second eight-man tag match that was going to become a classic in Southeastern history, this particular eight-man thing. And we're going to find out one of the main reasons for that, and this one here in particular. So the first match was totally out of control match. They got one referee injured before the second one even had a chance to get down to the ring. He ended up having to stop the match. So I'm going to be giving everyone a breakdown of the TV show in this studcast, the one that promoted the second eight-man tag and the rest of that card. Then we'll talk about the results of the matches themselves and the attendances in the three major markets of Southeastern Gulf Coast Territory. Then, Dave, hopefully we're going to have enough time for maybe another great learning tree question before we end today.
All right, cool deal. All right, it sounds like a lot going on in this studcast as always, Ron. I suppose we're going to begin with Grandfather Roy and what was his part? What was his part? What did he have to do with the National Wrestling Alliance?
Well, I think that's a great place to start, Dave. I mean, we've been starting with Roy here for quite a few studcasts now, and remember recently, we spent the last studcast, we talked about my family in many cases, and it's not, and I think we mentioned that, I feel like we've not really got the credit we deserve in my family because my grandfather, my father, and lots of others in my family, they didn't want to be recognized or credited or certainly put in the spotlight for anything, basically. So I remember when my first Southeastern Territory in Knoxville, after almost 3 years in operation, it burst upon the scene. It finally took off in 1977, started in 1974. 1977, it really took off. We began to sell out the Coliseum on a regular basis. And I remember my father advising me. He said, don't shine too bright a light or draw too much attention because it can only bring you trouble, man. And I couldn't understand that statement until about 2 years later when all of a sudden Bob Root and the Knoxville Five were running against me in my own territory.
Exactly.
So wow. It kind of made a lot of sense real quick at that point.
Yeah.
So that brings me to my grandfather and the formation of the National Wrestling Alliance in 1948. This is what our focus is going to be on our hidden history lesson for today. It was established in St. Louis, the home of the promoter and owner, Sam Muchnick. By 1973, which was my third year in the sport, I'd kind of become a star in Australia and definitely in Florida. And I had also attracted the eye of the president of the National Wrestling Alliance, Sam Muchnick, one of the alliance founders. So Sam began to book me in St. Louis to wrestle for him. And as my good friend Jack Briscoe had told me, he says, Ron, if you start getting a lot of shots in St. Louis, that's a great sign. He says, that means you're moving up in the business, because Jack went through that same process. He was a big star in Florida, and then they started bringing him into St. Louis.
Wow.
And the story from there on, he ended up being the world champion. So I wrestled there every other Friday night and also on a great number of Sam's TV shows. During a couple of years there. And so my first trip there, he invited me to come to his office. And I had no idea what I was going to see. I was totally blown away by the history in that building, man, and the fantastic number of photos. On every wall, it was loaded with, there was no space for another picture in that place. And there were photos of all of the sports, stars of the sports, man, including my father was in there, my grandfather was in there, Roy's three brothers were in there. So I spent much of that day in Sam's office trying to get my head around just how big the sport was in the world. I never realized that he had all the Japanese. He had everybody. It seemed like almost everybody that ever wrestled was on his wall. So Sam finally sent fine at the end of the afternoon some time for me, and he took me into his office, and we talked about his respect for my grandfather, and you know, and he was very upfront about it, and my entire family, and you know, of which you know. He said he had a special relationship for 40 years with members of my family, and that was true, definitely a fact. And so he told me how Roy, in the 18 years in Tennessee, before even the formation of the NWA, from 1930 basically to 1948, he said that Roy laid the foundation for wrestling in the South. And he told me how Roy had built one of the largest territories ever, was the first promoter in the South to become a member of the National Wrestling Alliance in his first year.
Wow. That had to be a pretty big day for you. I mean, I heard just getting booked in St. Louis one time was a really big deal. So it sounds like you were going to be there a lot, the way it seems to be setting up.
Yeah. You know, and a heck of a lot. Over the next 2 years, I worked more than 60 house shows and TV matches for Sam. So let's get into the National Wrestling Alliance. In order to limit our discussions here, Dave, not take up too much of this studcast, I'm going to try to keep the history of the NWA confined basically to the early years of when it was founded, 1948, up to about the mid-1980s, when it began to lose members and lose its power because of what was going on with McMahon. So a great place to start, I say, is from the very beginning. And who was in the original group that founded the National Wrestling Alliance in 1948? There were a group of six promoters and owners. They were primarily in the Midwest, Midwestern part of the country. First guy was named Paul. They called him Pinky. Paul Pinky George. He owned territory in Iowa, Joe Stecker, and a territory in Minnesota. Harry Light had a territory in Michigan. Sam Muchnick, obviously, had one there in St. Louis. Orville Brown had an office in Kansas City. And Al Haft in Columbus, Ohio. And Al Haft, that was the guy, Dave, that Roy actually started his career with. So he was one of the founders of the NWA.
Wow. Only six territories. And it sounds like all of those in neighboring states. So the NWA, what was it all about and how did it work?
Well, the National Wrestling Alliance operated basically what was considered a territory system. And it allowed the members to create their own regional champions. Which meant they could have Florida could have a Florida champion, and you know, they could have they couldn't have any national or world presence. You know, they had regional champions, and they all had to recognize one world champion. That was the thing, the presence, and the thing that made it different for the National Wrestling Alliance. And that world champion defended his title in all of the membership territories. Every one of them got to see the champion at some time during the year. And some of them got to see him quite regularly. All members could participate in talent exchanges, which was wonderful. It gave the guys an opportunity to work with each other. And if they wanted to, some didn't want to, and I'm sure some didn't do it at all. While the Alliance, you know, at the same time, it collectively protected the territorial integrity of all those member promotions. So it quickly became the largest organization of its kind. I mean, overnight, basically. In 1949, which was the first full year of its operation, it added 14 territories in 1949. My grandfather's Roy's territory was one of the first to join. In 1950, eight more were added, including Roy's Gulf Coast territory, down south there, where Dad moved us in 1954, along Mobile and Pensacola, in our Gulf Coast territory that we're talking about today. So that joined in 1950. In 1951, There were three more were added to the first one outside the United States. You had Stu Hart's Calgary territory in Canada. You had Jim Crockett's huge Mid-Atlantic territory and the Funks in Amarillo, 1951. In 1955, you had the first foreign country, Japan and Mexico, were added in 53. 1957, the McMahon family brought their Washington, D.C. and the New York territories into the NWA. Now, they were going to leave at a certain point, but they were members from 1957 for many years. In the 1960s, Australia came in, New Zealand came in, Vancouver on the West Coast, and Nova Scotia on the East Coast to Canada, they came in, and the Von Erichs in the Dallas Territory, plus four more came in 1960s. Hmm. In the 1970s, I put my first Southeastern Territory in the mix, Knoxville, along with Korea that year and three others. So in the total of these years, from 1948 to 1985, 48 territories, including 12 foreign countries, joined the NWA between 1948 to 1985.
Wow, that's pretty remarkable. I can't imagine what that room had to look like for conventions with all those all those huge wrestlers gathered, promoters gathered, filling it. I mean, a lot of foreign languages probably being spoken. So with all that going on, did things always go well for the NWA? How did it lay out?
Well, you know, not always. You know, there were occasions over the years, you know, when I was there, the tempers flared a bit. But I never saw anyone take a swing at a fellow member. You know, that was a good thing. You know, and I can't imagine how bad a brawl would have been if there had been something like that happening in those rooms.
Wow.
Oh, wow. I would have been the first one to make it to the door. Sure. Out there as fast as possible. So the worst problem they ever had occurred in 1956. And that was because there were allegations made that the NWA was an illegal monopoly blocking competition. And that led to the United States Department of Justice forming an investigation about the National Wrestling Alliance that ended up with several territories leaving the organization.
Wow. Okay, so as always, this has been another fascinating hidden history lesson. Do you have another, any personal stories, Ron, that happened to you there?
Well, one comes to mind right away, I can tell you that, Dave. You know, and 1974, the year I joined the NWA as an owner, mm-hmm. Southeastern Knoxville, the Southeastern Territory, was put into the National Wrestling Alliance. Sam Muchnick was still the president of the NWA at that point. And so in this meeting in 1974, he introduced me, and he had me stand up. You know, and then he said, you know, that I was only 26 years old. And he said he's the youngest territory owner in the history of this organization. You know, and I got a nice round of applause, you know. And so I was about to sit down. And then Sam said, don't sit down yet, Ron, because I have someone else I want to introduce. So Sam had a good sense of humor, and so he continued. And he said, "You know, Ron's going to be in my main event in St. Louis 2 weeks from today. The meeting's the last day of the meeting. No, the Friday. They always ended on a Friday." Mm-hmm. He said, 2 weeks from today, he's going to be wrestling in the main event for me." And he goes, "He's going to be wrestling for the Missouri State Championship against a former NWA champion." Mm-hmm. So then, you know, Sam asked Gene Koninsky, the owner of the Vancouver, Canada territory, to stand up. Gene Koninsky, man, he was widely known as the stiffest wrestler in the history of the business. Wow. Everybody hated to work with Gene, I know, man. So when Gene stood up, he was already laughing. You know, and that entire room popped. There I was standing up, and across the room from me is Gene Koninsky. I'm 26 years old, and so I never heard a roar like that. And all the times I went to the meeting, everybody in that room went nuts, man. So, you know, and everybody in the room, they knew what kind of night I was going to have in 2 weeks. That's what the deal was all about. The laughing was all about.
Wow. All right, that's a great story, Ron. So before we leave your grandfather, you got anything else you'd like to say about him? I mean, these last few weeks and the hidden history lessons have really been cool.
Well, I hope I haven't, you know, bored fans too badly with Roy's stories. I mean, I've told a bunch of them here, and I'd like to say a couple of quick things about his last 30 years and what he accomplished. He was the founder of the Mid-America Wrestling Territory. Basically, he finally gave the name of the Tennessee Territory, called it Mid-America Wrestling. And he left his footprints, man, all over Southern wrestling. And I love seeing the old cards on the Florida Archives Facebook group. They run these old cards and show what was on these cards and starting in the 1930s and 1940s. And I look at that and I see Roy's name there all through the 1940s and 1950s. Herb was there, you know, and he was making appearances in that state almost every winter. And I bet many of those he had Ginger with him, you know, so. And, you know, and the fact that he trained the first bear kind of speaks for itself, really, man. So the 1950s, it brought television to America. And from the very beginning, wrestling was one of the most popular shows on television. And my dad used to tell me, he said, back in the day, people couldn't afford the TVs. And they lived in a little town in Dyersburg, and they had these big old stores that would have the TVs, and they would put them in the windows, the store windows. And Dad said that when wrestling came on, he said the sidewalks, and people would be standing on the sidewalks and out into the street watching wrestling on television through the window. They couldn't afford a television set, but they would come down to these stores where they had the TV sets and watch wrestling in the streets. And so in that decade, before there was videotape, all the TV stations had to air the wrestling shows. They aired the local shows live. And all of them were obviously on Saturdays. Mm-hmm. Have always been traditionally wrestling's day. And each station was going to have at least 10 wrestlers there for the 1 hour show. You know, you had to do that. You had to send these wrestlers. And he was, now think about it, Roy was operating in 8 states with 14 TV stations airing on the same day in just 4 of those states, 14 TV stations. So he was operating in 8 states. I mean, so, you know, that required him to have at least 140 wrestlers every Saturday scheduled to be on a specific television station at a specific time. Mm-hmm. Accomplishment of that feat alone is mind-boggling to me. I mean, how do you do that? I don't know. I don't know how he got that done. But Roy was running one of the biggest territories in history. He filled it with hundreds of stars, obviously. And in that decade and the next, he really cranked out business. He was basically a pioneer, man. He was a trailblazer in the sport. And those same years, he accomplished and something else completely different that was just as awesome as what he did in wrestling. During those same years, he built one of the largest dairies in America. So I guess a good name for a good way of putting it, Roy was kind of an alpha male, man. he put his family on the path that was taken by very few men to become a wrestler and ultimately a sport that was enjoyed by millions. And we wouldn't have been there if it hadn't been for Roy that took that first step. And he left some mighty big shoes to fill and some mountains to climb. And there'll never be another Roy Welch.
Wow. Well said, Stud. What size is your foot?
It's about a 13.
That's what I
said. It's probably a little bigger than Roy's feet, as a matter of fact. But, and I don't know that I climbed all the mountains Roy did either.
Yeah, I don't know. You still got a few mountains ahead of you, maybe. All right, listen, before we take our break, can you set us up for Mobile, Alabama? Take us to Mobile, Alabama for Tuesday, April 8th, 1980.
I certainly can, man. And the opening match was Ricky Fields, that local boy, Lee Fields' son, against Bill Dromo. Roy Lee Welch was taking on Randy Rose. Eddie Boulder was facing Big Ron Bass in his second week in the territory. And there was a 10-round boxing match. The fabulous Don Fargo was going to be fighting against Charlie Cook. And then there was a United States Junior Heavyweight Championship match, a return match, because Norville lost and had won the belt from Tony Charles the week before. And he was going to be defending it for the first time against Tony Charles. And the main event was another one of those eight-man tags. And this one was a Texas Death Rules match. It meant it was no disqualification, no time limit. It meant falls don't count. The match would continue after each one of those falls. After a man got beat, they gave him a 30-second rest period. Then he had to attend count to get to his feet. Or that's the way the match would end. So the contestants for this eight-man tag was a Mongolian Stomper, Jimmy Golden, the Big C, and Dr. Bill Irwin against the Georgia Jawjacker, Joe LeDuc, Robert, and me.
All right, cool deal. That's a great card. An eight-man tag with Texas Deathmatch rules, a United States Junior title return match, a 10-round boxing match, and three other matches. So we're going to be finding out what was on the TV show promoting this card, setting it all up, and more when we come back after the break as this Studcast continues. All right, Studcast fans, you've been waiting for it, and it's here. Can you believe 16 of these already? It's the Ask the Stud question and answer show. And Stud, it's this Saturday. That's cool.
Yeah, it's going to be April 20th, and I love these shows. I get so much enjoyment out of answering these questions, and wow, I got such knowledgeable fans out there. This one is going to be the 16th one. I mean, that's hard to believe. Time is just flying by, but I'm really looking forward to it again. I've already got a tremendous number of questions, great questions, as a matter of fact. But if some people are listening today and they would like to have one last opportunity, I'd say Wednesday, certainly no later than Thursday morning, you better get your question in, and you can leave them on my social media sites, on my Facebook and my Twitter. Just go look for the post that says leave your questions here, and we'll try to get them in there. Wow, we're getting so many questions, and so many people are enjoying these and getting involved in it that it's really become a regular thing here for me, and I really enjoy it. So yeah, make sure you want to give us a chance. Only place you can find it exclusively, it's on YouTube, Southeastern Rewind.
Hey, let me ask you, how many questions typically per show?
Normally somewhere between 10 and 15.
So to me, it's like the learning tree on steroids.
Yeah, well, that's a good way of putting it. That's what it is. I mean, it's a bunch of learning tree questions.
And
the questions are usually phenomenal.
And you take pretty much any kind of question.
Oh, yeah. Heck yeah, I'll answer anything, man. You can ask me whatever you want, as long as it has something to do with wrestling.
Yeah.
You know, I'll do my best to give you a good answer.
So you don't take just comments like, Ron, my oldest boy just got a new coloring book. You don't take stuff like that.
No.
Not comments, but questions.
Okay. Just questions, okay. Man. Good, legitimate questions. Something about wrestling. And, I got a pretty good background in it, and I can answer pretty much everything.
Ron, how old do you think Charlie Platt really is? You don't take.
I don't want to answer that question.
So you don't take stuff like All right, so that's got type stuff. All right, that's cool, though. So about 10 questions. So you're probably talking about an hour-long show, right?
Yes, it's always, they always run at least an hour, sometimes more than an hour.
Yeah, that to me, that is so cool how you get to, you get the responses back to the folks, I mean, just straight away in the, in about a one-hour show, and questions coming from literally all over everywhere. That is really cool. All right, so set us up one more time. It's this coming Saturday, and this is episode number 16, right?
Yep, Ask the Stud 16, man. And, yep, like I say, if you jump in there quick, Wednesday and Thursday, this comes out on a Wednesday, and then maybe Thursday morning, get, if you have, want to, you still have an opportunity, have one last shot to get you, throw your hat in the ring, man.
That is so cool. It's all about old school wrestling. Got to check it out. Ask the Stud, number 16, YouTube, Southeastern Rewind, this coming Saturday. Check it out. All right, cool deal. Welcome back in, Studcast fans. We are ready, Stud, for the TV show that promoted the card that you set up for us right before the break for the second week of April, 1980, Southeastern Wrestling. So how did the TV show open?
Well, it was similar to the last week's TV, except there had been a change of a major title in the past week. Norvell Austin had won the United States Junior Championship from Tony Charles during the course of the week, and Charlie Platt opened up by running down the card for the show. And the studio audience was not aware of the title change, because the title change stands in Mobile during the week, and so they didn't know about it. So when Norvell came out of the dressing room and he headed over for the set, the cameras caught a shot of him, and he had the championship belt on, but he had it buckled around his street clothes. And the studio audience, they didn't like the fact that Norvell had won the championship, and I guess they saw that he was disrespecting the belt, and they just booed the heck out of it. The show opened with the crowd booing right off the bat, and he loved it, man. You know, he stopped and he turned and he smiled at him, and then he raised both of his hands over his head and he strutted the rest of the way to the set, man. And he sat down, with the belt still strapped around his clothes and watched the video of how he won it. So he was wearing the belt. By wearing the belt in that way, you know, it was a way of showing real disrespect for it, as way I always thought it was. And he got that idea because when he started wrestling, he was partners with Sputnik Monroe a great deal of times. A lot of times they were a great tag team, man. And Sputnik used to, when they won the belts, Sputnik was the guy that always put them on with his clothes on, right? In fact, Sputnik used to sometimes go downtown in Memphis and walk the streets with his belt on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's where this idea came from, Norvell. That's where he got the idea. So then, the video they watched, it clearly showed him in the end of it beating Tony Charles with his feet on the ropes. The referee never saw it, right? So Charlie covered the fact that Norvell was going to have a rematch with Charles the next week. Tony was in the first TV match of the day, right? And he invited Austin, you know, to stay with him at the set and watch him, right? Make some comments if you'd like to. Well, Norvell declined, and he headed back to the dressing room. Before he got to the dressing room, Tony Charles just exploded out of the other dressing room and ran. He was very upset with the disrespect that poor old Norvell had shown for his belt. And Tony always considered that to be his belt, man. So and he almost got to Austin, but Austin saw him coming, and he able to slide in the dressing room door before Charles got there. So I wouldn't have wanted to be the wrestler, man, that was waiting on Tony Charles in the ring. It was a bad start for whoever he was wrestling. A short match, obviously, and everything Tony was feeling about losing his belt, he took it out on that poor guy in the ring. So the second segment opened up with Don Fargo, who was already at the set with Charlie. During the commercial break, he went to the set, and he had his fist taped, and he reminded Charlie, and if you remember, those who remember something about The Last TV, Fargo said, you know, if I can't beat that football player in 30 minutes, I know what type of match I want, and I'll be back here, and I'll tell you what it is. So, you know, so there he was. He had his fist taped, so, you know, and he was, you know, and so then he wanted, obviously, and he told Charlie as soon as he got an opportunity, he slammed his fist into his tape fist into one of his hands, and he says, I want a brass knucks match. That's what I want. And, you know, so, you know, and he says, I want to show this football player what I got in store for him, man. So Charlie told him, you know, he was kind of sorry to hear that, because he said, Don Curtis is in charge of setting up the matches. And he said, I got to tell you, he goes, you're going to be in the ring again with Charlie Cook, but he says, it's not going to be in a brass knucks match. He goes, you're going to be in a 10-round boxing match with Charlie Cook. And he says to Charlie, he says to Fargo, he says, you know that Charlie Cook is a pretty good football player, you know, and he said, but he just happens to be a great boxer too, right? So the studio audience exploded on that. They were like, oh yeah, boy, Fargo, you're going to get it now. So then Charlie Cook entered the ring for the second match, and he was wearing boxing gloves, and he was dancing around the ring, and he was pointing his gloves at Don Fargo sitting over there to sit with Charlie, imitating Muhammad Ali, kind of, right? You know, like, I'm going to get you, right? So Fargo jumped up, and Charlie was asking him if he wanted to stay to watch his next opponent, but Fargo was halfway to the dressing room by then, you know. So the studio audience, they loved it. They had another big cheer, and then Charlie, you know, removed the boxing gloves, and he set them in his corner, and he tore into his opponent. And he showed that he not only could box, but he had some wrestling skills as well, you know. So, you know, then he got himself a good win, but it wasn't over at this point. So he went back over and he put the boxing gloves back on, and he was dancing around the ring again. And Fargo had sneaked around to the front of the television studio, and he came in the entrance where the fans do. And he still had his fist taped, and he sneaked into the ring behind Cook's back. Cook never saw him there. And then Fargo spun him around and took a swing at Charlie. And Cook was quick, man. He ducked that punch, and he hit Fargo right on the jaw with a big right hand. And that sent Fargo face first onto the mat, you know. And then another explosion from the studio crowd. Charlie just left the ring and kept his gloves on. Left the ring, and they came and hauled Fargo out.
Obviously, this TV's off to a roaring start. So set up the personality profile. Who was on that?
Well, the other four men in the 8-man tag match from the week before. Last week, it had been this, the Stomper and Jimmy. It had been me and Rob and Joe LaDuke and the new man, the Georgia Jawjacker. So this time we put the other four guys into the profile, and they were standing there. They were sitting down. Charlie was sitting down next to Big C, and Stomper and Jimmy Golden and Dr. Bill Ehrlichman were standing up behind them in the chairs. And they watched the closing moments of the first one of these 8-man tag matches. And it showed that two referees were involved in the match, and it was a wild one, and it ended with both teams being disqualified. And then they covered the fact that this next tag match was going to be a no disqualification, no time limit, Texas Death, 8-man tag. And these Texas Death matches, man, they were one of the most dangerous matches in all of wrestling. And especially when you had 8 guys involved, it was going to last a long time. Mm. Because you had an opportunity, you got pinned, but you had an opportunity to get up and start over again.
Yeah.
So there were going to be two referees from the very start of this match. rather than one going and then another one coming down later to help him out, it was going to have two referees for the entire match. The Big C did all the talking for his team, naturally, and it was all based around the dislike between the two teams and the fact that some of them, you know, somebody was going to get hurt, you know, real bad. Yeah, I mean, that's what happened in Texas death matches. A guy had to be laying there after being down four or five times and getting back on his feet. He had to be laying there until he couldn't get up. And these matches were really, really dangerous. So sad part about that is it actually happened for real. Somebody's going to get hurt in this tag match for real.
Oh, wow. So I guess we're going to hear all about that when you get to the results of the 8-man tag match coming up soon, I'm assuming. So how about the next TV match? Who was in that one?
Well, Ron Bass. But first, Ron came to the set with his famous bull rope. He didn't even have it from the week before. And the bull rope was just a plaited rope, and it had a cowbell, a metal cowbell tied in the middle of the rope. So Charlie wasn't expecting me to even come to the set, and he kind of let Bass know that. But Bass wasn't the type of guy that was going to apologize, that's for sure, for being there. And he just got straight to the point. And he told Charlie he was in Southeastern for one reason only, that he had come here to get something done. That 17 months ago, November 1979, Joe LeDuc and him were the Southwest Tag Team Champions until, as he put it, the yellow-bellied Canadian for no reason turned on me, and they put me in the hospital for 6 months. Almost ended my career, he told Charlie. And then he said, LeDuc then left the area and he disappeared. And he said he's obviously trying to hide from me, and he has done a good job of it. And he said he'd been searching for LeDuc for almost a year. And then he said he got his good friend, Dr. Bill Irwin, who's in this 8-man tag. He said he called me up and let me know, I know where Joe LeDuc is. He's right here where I am. So he said that's how he finally found out about it. And now he was ready to return the favor to old Joe LeDuc. And he was going to make sure that Joe LeDuc spent some lengthy time in the hospital himself. So he said he wanted a match with Joe immediately, you know, and he wanted a bull rope match so that he could have LeDuc admitted to the nearest hospital as soon as possible. And meanwhile, he said, I'm going to show everybody what this bull rope can do. By this time, his opponent was in the ring. He'd been there during this whole couple of minutes here. And he was waiting on Bass. And so Bass just charged in the ring, and he never even dropped the bull rope. He never put it down. The referee tried to stop him. He just grabbed the rep, threw him over the top rope, and he went straight across the ring to the poor son of a gun that's wrestling him, and he hit him in the head with the cowbell right off the bat. And he busted him open, obviously, and while the kid was just bleeding all over everything, and the timekeeper instantly started ringing the bell, but he disqualified it, and the referee, was thrown over the top rope for a second time, and Bass made his point, and he went back to the set with Charlie before he went to the dressing room, and he swung his cowbell across the desk where Charlie was sitting. And the bell part of it landed on the desk, boy, with a crash. And Charlie went scrambling away from the set. So Bass grabbed the microphone, and he was going to have his say, man. So he grabbed the microphone, and then he screamed to Joe LeDuc, probably back there in the dressing room watching it, that this was the last time that this was going to happen. He was going to settle this once and for all, you know, and he was going to get it done as quickly as he could. So then Charlie kind of eased back up to the set, and he tried to calm Bass down, but Bass stormed off to the dressing room, and that was kind of the way that particular third segment ended.
Wow, you certainly get somebody's attention like that when – Ron Bass, was a huge guy, and I don't remember him doing anything that bad before when he was wrestling, like, in Gulf Coast, it must have taken a few minutes to get everything, I guess, back in order. So how about the last match on the TV show?
Well, it was another eight-man tag. And like the last match from the TV before, except this time the teams were switched again. And so last time it had been the other team that was in the match. And so the fans went crazy, man, when Georgia Jawjacker and Rob and me and Joe LeDuc came out of the dressing room and headed to the ring. Wow, they were like, geez, man, they much preferred that to the one they got to see the week before. So we were not getting an easy team to beat either, you know. Just like the last week, they got a tough team. We put some tough guys in there for them. So we ended up in there against Randy Rose and Bill Dromo and Ted and Jerry Oates, two great brothers out of Columbus, Georgia. So it was really a good TV match. It actually went for about 20 minutes, which is a long time for a television match. And during that time, we showed a lot of teamwork from the four of us and who we'd not been in a ring together before these eight-man tags started. So we hadn't. It was a good warm-up for us, and it gave us the opportunity to really work as a team. So the Georgia Jawjacker, you know, he finally got the win over Jerry Oates. But we all spent time watching out for Ron Bass, man. You know, after what he had just done, figuring, you know, he might be coming out there again, bringing his cowbell.
Yeah, I don't blame anybody for that. He seemed to be out of control. So this was a really different kind of TV show, but very interesting. So set up Mobile for us. What happened in Mobile 3 days later on that big card there?
Well, Ricky Fields went to a time limit draw with the much larger Bill Dromo. Bill Dromo was probably at least 75 pounds heavier than Ricky Fields. But Ricky hung in there, and he got himself a 15-minute time limit draw with Dromo. Randy Rose won his match over Roy Lee Welch. Ron Bass had no mercy on Eddie Boulder, man, and getting his victory. But thankfully for Eddie, I should say, he didn't bring the bull rope to the ring with him. You know, he left that in the dressing room. So then in the 10-round boxing match, Charlie Cook looked like a boxing star. He was unreal. I watched it. It was like, wow, I never knew he could box. And so he just dominated Fargo in the first four rounds of it, you know. And so after the fourth round, Fargo went back, you know, and sat down on the stool. We had stools there like, you know, they do for boxing. And as he sat there in the corner, I noticed he was bending over, and I couldn't see what his deal was. He had his arms down by his side, and so during the course of the break, he was shaking the glove off of his right hand. And when the bell rang for the fifth round, he got up and turned his back to the referee and Charlie Cook, and he reached in his tights and he brought out his brass knucks and he put one on his hand, man. And he went to work on Charlie Cook. Referee rang the bell, stopped the match, but Fargo, he didn't pay any attention to it, man. And he had Charlie Cook pretty bloody and down for the count. But the referee refused to count or raise his hand, obviously, you know. So Tony Charles wrestling in the next match to see if he could get his belt back from Norvell Austin. And he sees what's going on up there. And Charlie's pretty bloody, and he's down face first, and Fargo's stomping him in the back of the head. And so Tony Charles went down to the ring to get Fargo off of Charlie. And then Fargo caught him, man, with a shot just before he left the ring. And it cut Tony Charles. He hit him with those brass knucks on, and that kind of cut Charles, and it partially knocked him about half out. I could tell by looking that he's not ready to wrestle now for sure. But Norvell Austin, I guess he was on the other side of the building. He saw it too. And he took his belt and he rushed down to the ring and he demanded that the referee start the United States Junior Heavyweight title match. Even though Charles is over there bleeding and leaning over in the corner. And you know, Charlie Cook was trying to help him to regain his thoughts and get his head together. And then Cook was forced to leave the ring, and then the referee rang the bell for the match, and Austin just shot across the ring. He never gave Tony a shot and never gave a chance. He hit him a couple of shots. He pile-drived him right there in the corner and then put his feet on the ropes and beat him again. Wow. The referee never saw it.
Wow. It seems like this was already a crazy night. My guess is the next match was the Texas Death 8-man tag match. This is the one I've been looking forward to. I want to hear about this. So set it up for us, Ron.
Well, before I talk about the last match, Dave, I'm going to give everybody the attendances in the three major markets, like we normally do, but we normally do it after. And there's a reason that I'm going to do it this way. Montgomery had 3,800 that week. Mobile had its third Expo Hall sellout in a row, 5,600. And Dothan had 4,100. So let's get to that last match of the night. It had two referees, like I said, but was still very much out of control of most of the match. It didn't make any difference. I think if it had four referees, probably wouldn't have been enough. But the referees were having a hard time keeping the three men on each team in the corners and trying to make the teams do legal tags. And there were a lot of pins by everyone. I think probably everybody, all eight at one time or another, got pinned in this match, at least once, but were able to get to their feet. Match went on for a long time, maybe 45 minutes. Like I said, there was lots of pins, but everybody was able to get up before the 30-second rest period and the 10 count. That's the way these Texas Death matches work. You had a 30-second rest period. They rang the bell. Referee counted to 10. If you couldn't get up, you lost the match. But everybody had gotten up. Dr. Bill Irwin and Chola Duke were bleeding at this point in that match. And Bill Irwin had been pinned twice, but got up twice, and he was able to make a tag back to his teammates. And Joe was the last one on our team to be in that position like Irwin was. In fact, he had lost three falls in a row, but he had been up three times. So Jimmy Golden, as I mentioned a couple of studcasts ago, was still having the back problem. And he'd not been in the ring very much in this match. And basically, he was being protected by his partners because of his bad back. And they were trying to keep him out of the ring. And oddly enough, that was what the team had been working on and focusing on was Joe's back. So they had been slamming and suplexing, and they had given Joe all these big bumps. And so Jimmy was tagged in, and he picked up a bloody Joe LaDuke just to give him a simple body slam. And wow, his back went suddenly totally limp. LaDuke was in his arms and Jimmy collapsed. One leg went sliding out from under him, behind him, and the other leg went forward. All of Joe's weight landed on top of Golden. And the thousands of fans were screaming, man, it's a sold out Midland. And suddenly it was such a horrible looking way that he went down, you know, that the building just went silent. And just seeing the contorted shape of Jimmy's body, there was Joe LaDuke kind of laying over part of his body, and Jimmy's legs were spread out and wrong. Wow, it just, everybody in the building knew something horrible had just happened. I mean, and Jimmy screamed, and then that scream brought a moan from the crowd, like, oh, God. So Joe rolled over on top of him, man. What else is he going to do? Right? Covered him. The referee counted Jimmy out, and Joe came back to the corner. Joe LaDuke was such a soft-hearted guy. When Joe LaDuke got back to the corner, he was crying. Jimmy laid there during the entire 30-second rest period.
Wow.
Then they rang the bell, and the referee started counting. He didn't make a move. He never moved. Referee counted to 10, and he still did not move. The ref rang the bell and raised our hands, and all three of the men in Jimmy's corner, they went right straight to Jimmy, man. It was one of the most awkward moments I had ever experienced in my time in the ring. Never before or after did I see something like that that affected me this badly. And it was the same. It was the same for the crowd. They didn't even cheer when they raised our hand. It's like everybody realized this is horrible. This ain't good.
Wow.
So we left the ring, and Jimmy laid there with all three of his partners on their knees around him, and they stayed with him until he was loaded onto a stretcher. And, you know, an ambulance was there. We used to have an ambulance all the time in Mobile in case they needed it, not just for wrestlers, but maybe for, somebody in the crowd. But so they stayed there with him, and they loaded him onto a stretcher, and they walked beside him as they rolled him out of the building, and they put him into the ambulance.
Wow. What a horrible injury. I've never seen heard anything like that at a wrestling match. So what happened to Jimmy after that?
Well, he spent 3 days in the hospital. Then he went home from the hospital in an ambulance. He spent the next month flat on his back.
Wow.
He moved away from Pensacola to Birmingham, and he gave up wrestling, the only business he had ever known.
Wow, what a sad story to end with today, especially since we don't have enough time for a learning tree question, Ron. So I'm sorry, I can't leave it like this, Stud. So surely someone could help him, right?
Well, he had thankfully done that for himself, Dave. He's not going to have any income, basically, or he wouldn't have had any income, but he was smart enough that he had bought a piece of the Southeastern Gulf Coast territory from me when I bought it from the Fields brothers 2 years earlier. Rob bought a piece, Roy Lee bought a piece, Bob Armstrong bought a piece, and Jimmy. And thankfully, Jimmy had done that, because these crowds that we were drawing, these sellouts, he got his money. He owned part of the company. I didn't care whether he could wrestle again, but he certainly was entitled to what he had bought. And it paid him a mighty nice dividend at the end of every month. Mm. You know, it kept him and his family going. But great thing about it, the best part about it, man, it wasn't going to be the end of Jimmy Golden.
Well, I'll tell you what, I know why people love these studcasts, because you never know what to expect, and we've just witnessed that. This one had a little bit of everything, Stud. So where are you going to take us next week?
Well, I'm going to go a different direction with the next hidden history lesson. Then we're going to talk about the Mobile main event. We're going to have an opportunity to get into the main arena, which didn't happen for us very often. And since it was available, we were going to take advantage of it, man. We booked one of the best cards in the history of that part of the country, probably. The main event was going to be an 8-man tag in the steel cage with the Stomper, Big C, Dr. Bill Irwin. And that team was going to have a mystery partner to take Jimmy Golden's place, obviously. And hopefully after that, we'll have enough time next week to have another learning tree question as well.
All right, good deal. So, man, this has been a fun one, I tell you. And folks, you know what to do. If you're looking for Ron on social media, on Facebook especially, you find Ron at Ron Fuller Welch, Ron Fuller, the Tennessee Stud, on Facebook. Like and follow him there. Automatically become friends with a living legend on Twitter, now known as X. On Twitter or X, Ron Fuller Welch, and follow him there also. You can check out Ron's fantastic website, tnstud.com. This studcast is going to be there. Every studcast ever done is there. Shop the stud store, where you get 43 super studcasts, 4 different 8x10 photos, the thrilling Lion novel, Brutus personally autographed to you hand t-shirt still on sale for only $15.99 with free shipping. And subscribe now at YouTube Southeastern Rewind. Get the best in old school wrestling, 419 videos, the last 121 studcast, 52 stud stories, 114 short rides with the stud. And now coming this weekend, as you heard about earlier, the new Ask the Stud 16 question and answer show. It's going to be phenomenal. All this, especially exclusively on YouTube Southeastern Rewind. It is the best deal in old school wrestling. All right, any final comments, Stud?
Well, I want to thank those fans, man, that sent the questions for the new Ask the Stud show that we're going to be airing on Saturday. And I know everybody else out there for your support. And I hope you join us again next week. And please take care of yourselves and others. And may God bless us all.
For Ron Fuller in the Great Smoky Mountains, I'm David Summers saying thank you for listening. Find me at davidsummersproductions@gmail.com. This Studcast is a David Summers production for Tennessee Stud LLC.
Thanks for joining us today for this historic Studcast. The true story continues next week. So fool Nelson your friends and point them in our direction for another ride with the Tennessee Stud.
1, 2, 3.
This is David Summers saying so long from the Great Smoky Mountains.